And it gives me great pleasure now to introduce two of the co-leads. And you'll first be hearing from Dr. Richard Swartz. Dr. Swartz is a stroke neurologist and clinical scientist who directs the Sunnybrook Stroke Research Unit in the Department of Medicine at Sunnybrook Health Sciences Center in Toronto. Dr. Swartz also serves as a medical director of the Regional Stroke Network and is the vice chair of research for the Canadian Stroke Consortium. His research focuses on improving the long-term outcomes of people with stroke, vascular cognitive impairment, and vascular contributions to neurodegenerative diseases. Then you'll also hear from Dr. Mario Masellis. Dr. Masellis obtained his master's in pharmacology from the University of Toronto in 1997 and completed his medical training at the University of Toronto in 2001 and obtained his board certification in neurology since 2006. He has completed clinical research fellowships in cognitive and movement disorders neurology in 2008 and obtained his PhD in clinical neurosciences in 2012. His clinical expertise is in the diagnosis and management of both Alzheimer's and non-Alzheimer's dementias, including Lewy body disorders, frontotemporal dementia, progressive supranuclear palsy, and corticobasal syndrome. His research focuses on how genomic factors impact neuroimaging and cognitive phenotypes and response to drugs in neurodegenerative diseases. That's quite a mouthful for a guy with Parkinson's, but over to you, good doctors.
Thank you so much, Larry. That was extraordinary. Thank you for sharing your story, your inspiration, and the call for more cowbell. this is a really tough act to follow, not just the accent, but the content and the person. So what a great setup for the whole day. What a great setup for what ONDRI is and where we're going and what we hope HANDDS Ontario can be. So it's my pleasure and privilege to sort of kick things off from the scientific perspective and introduce this group, this audience, to ONDRI and what we are and what we do, and to the HANDDS Ontario project. Ruth, give me a thumbs up if my screen is sharing okay. Thank you. First, I want to acknowledge the Ontario Brain Institute. ONDRI is funded by OBI, as we call it, the Ontario Brain Institute. This is an initiative funded by the provincial government to improve the lives of Ontarians living with a brain disorder. And the goal of OBI is to really connect research, discovery, care, and commercialization across multiple different neurological conditions, and to really build networks to connect people who may not always be connected: researchers, patients, companies, private sector, health charities, and policymakers. You can see that ONDRI, the Ontario Neurodegenerative Research Initiative, fits in here with five other conditions. There's a, we call these integrated discovery platforms, or programs actually. OBI calls them programs. I like to refer to it as a platform. Looking at cerebral palsy, epilepsy, neurodevelopmental disorders like ADHD and autism, concussion and depression, and ONDRI, as you're going to hear a lot more about, looking at neurodegenerative diseases. Our goal within ONDRI is really to improve the diagnosis, prognosis, or outcomes, and care for people living with neurodegenerative diseases, stroke, and dementia. That's really what we're all about. And the way we do this is what we call research care partnerships. We really want to build partnerships to connect and to advance discovery in basic science, discovery at the individual function level and at the health system level, so that we can direct resources where they're needed and improve care and outcomes from a system perspective as well. And so our goal as researchers is to be hitting on all those layers from basic science, individual function, care and outcomes, and health system levels for persons living with dementia and neurodegenerative diseases. And we have kind of divided artificially ONDRI into four aims, just to get our heads around all the different things that happen within ONDRI. These are more integrated, and as you'll hear, we have leaders and participants who cross these different aims. But it's a great sort of heuristic, a way of sort of understanding all the things that happen within ONDRI. And remember that these are all happening, as we just said, across that basic science discovery, individual function, putting the patient at the center of everything we do, and how that patient navigates through the healthcare system. So aim one we refer to as mining the gold of the original ONDRI study. And we're going to introduce that in a little more detail a few slides from now. But this study was done, a very, very detailed study looking across multiple different measures, looking at MRI scans and detailed cognitive assessments and gait and eye tracking and looking at retinal photographs and looking at people's balance and multiple different measures of function across neurodegenerative diseases and over time. We are still mining this gold, even of the baseline study, let alone the longitudinal study. And unfortunately, in the way of science, this takes a long time, really, to get all that data ready. We're making that data open to the scientific community, anonymized, of course, but available to the broader community outside of Ontario, even outside of Canada, worldwide, because we want to be able to fit into the worldwide efforts. So our Parkinson's cohort can contribute and compare with worldwide Parkinson's cohorts. And remembering that, as you'd heard, ONDRI really focuses across diseases. So we have a mild cognitive impairment and an Alzheimer's cohort. We have a cerebrovascular disease cohort. We have Parkinson's, ALS, and frontotemporal dementia. So multiple different diseases. And comparing across those cohorts, comparing with other cohorts we're going to talk about in a moment. But aim one is really about that Rubik's Cube you see, where we have these multiple dimensions of assessments across neurodegenerative diseases and over time. We'll just go back one slide for a second, because aim two, I just want to, I'm in charge of the slides, but it's not going back for me. There we go. Aim two is what we call ONDRI at home. And this is really what Larry was talking about with the Tom Cruise picture. We really want to move both research and discovery to the point where it can impact care. Most of the care for persons with neurodegenerative disease, as Larry was alluding to, and as people who are here today well know, does not happen in the hospital, and it doesn't happen in specialist's office. It happens on the couch, as Larry so eloquently described. It happens when you get off the couch, and it happens each day as you struggle with the ups and downs and ins and outs of getting to know and getting to sort of through the various challenges that these diseases present. And so ONDRI at home is about bringing this discovery to the place where it's needed, looking at health and function at home and in the community. And that's, we're gonna hear a lot about that with the sample of the wearable devices. And as we build HANDDS Ontario, you're gonna hear how it's integrating all these aims. Aim three, we call validation through collaboration. And that is, as we alluded to earlier, taking our detailed studies and comparing them and contrasting them and collaborating with international efforts and national efforts to advance discovery. And aim four is looking at health services outcomes. So using Ontario has a very rich database stored at the Institute for Clinical and Evaluative Sciences, ICIS. There we store health encounters so we can understand when and how often people have to visit the emergency room or have to be supported in institutions for like long-term care or complex continuing care, or even have outpatient doctor visits. And so it's a very rich way and robust way to understand how individuals are navigating through the healthcare system and where there might be gaps, opportunities, and chances to support. And all of this is with the collaboration of our PCAC, our Patient and Community Advisory Committee, of whom Larry is a key member, as you heard. So our initial AIM-1 foundation study looked at 520 people across these diseases with 520 care partners across domains. Whoa, that was fast, sorry. Clinical genomics, so this is genetic detail, neuropsychology, gait and balance, eye tracking, neuroimaging, retinal imaging, and neuropathology. As we mentioned, the patient community advisory committee is integral. So the patient voice is helping to drive the questions that we ask and the discoveries that we make. We have a very robust neuroinformatics and biostatistics core, because you can imagine there is literally billions of pieces of information in a study this detailed. And we need robust ways of handling that, of ensuring the data quality, especially if we're releasing it to the international community, and of processing it all. And that's also leveraged and supported by BrainCode, which is OBI's robust neuroinformatics and data platforms. We are fortunate within ONDRI, my computer is not cooperating, that we are developing new assessment platforms. And here I'm gonna ask Dr. Masellis, the third ONDRI co-lead that you heard about with Dr. Munoz and myself, to really talk about some of the molecular pathology and discovery that we've been adding on, and that's gonna form another key piece of the HANDDS Ontario platform that I'll be discussing in a moment. Mario.
Great, thanks so much, Rick. So I also want to just echo, a thanks to Larry for that excellent introduction. I think, Larry nicely communicated that Parkinson's disease doesn't only affect the motor system causing movement troubles like tremor and stiffness, but it can also affect mood. It can also affect cognition. And similarly, other diseases like Alzheimer's disease can also present with Parkinsonism, and we can see Parkinsonian features in patients who initially started out with a diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. And so we're trying to understand the differences and also similarities across all of these disorders. The reason why we've more recently added on the molecular pathology platform is that, making a diagnosis clinically, so when we see you in the office and when we see a patient in the office and their family, and we use tests to and exam maneuvers to diagnose someone, we are not always 100% accurate. So sometimes someone with Alzheimer's disease may actually end up having frontotemporal dementia, and that may take several years to realize that. And similarly, someone who has Parkinson's disease may down the road develop other features that can resemble cognitive impairment and dementia, and it takes time for that to develop. And one reason why that might happen is because there may be co-synergy between different changes in the brain. So for example, a condition called Lewy body dementia is almost like a hybrid between Parkinson's disease and Alzheimer's disease. And indeed, we can see both Alzheimer's changes in the brain along with Parkinson's changes in the brain. So we need to develop markers to allow us to indicate that may give us an indication that someone may have two different changes in the brain. So I'd like to move to the next slide, please. So one way that we've done this in ONDRI 1, using the ONDRI 1 cohort, is making advances in the genomics world. So if you recall, during the first study, we did two genetic assessments or genomic assessments. One is called the ONDRI-seq and the other is called NeuroXGen. And what these technologies allowed us to do is the ONDRI-seq allowed us to sequence genes that were associated with all of the different neurodegenerative diseases. So Dr. Hegeli and Dr. Rogeva and several of the clinicians involved in ONDRI developed the ONDRI-seq panel, which looked at the top 80, what we call candidate genes, and that we were able to sequence to see if we could identify genetic variants that were already known or new variants within these genes that might be associated or causative of the diseases that they had. For example, we could find Parkinson's disease variants in someone with Parkinson's disease and Alzheimer's disease variants in someone with Alzheimer's disease. And what was interesting using this panel, we also identified individuals that had, for example, Parkinson's disease, but may also had Alzheimer's disease variants. So that's one way we were trying to understand the genetic risk for these disorders and why people may who suffer from these disorders may have similar presentations across the different diseases based on genetics. However, these older technologies, ONDRI-seq and NeuroX-chip, while we learned a lot about the underlying genetic risk for these disorders and shared genetic risk for that matter, these were looking at genes we already knew about. And so in the recent times, there have been significant developments both in our technology to do what's called genome sequencing or whole genome sequencing, where we can look at an individual's entire genetic makeup in detail to identify new variants that we have not discovered in the past. We've been lucky enough to get funding from the OBI and also from the McLaughlin Center for Molecular Genetics at the Hospital of Sick Children to do genome sequencing on a subset of the ONDRI-1 cohort. So this allows us once again to discover new variants that may cause their neurodegenerative disease or increase risk for their neurodegenerative disease that we did not know existed. So that's a new development, and we'll be contacting individuals for re-consent to use their existing DNA samples. This is not to for you to come in to do any other tests as that you were involved in, but just to see if you would be interested in allowing us to use your DNA samples that are banked at the University of Western Ontario for future use. Next slide. As I also alluded to, we are not always 100% accurate in diagnosing someone with Alzheimer's or with Parkinson's disease, and sometimes individuals may have shared features across these different diseases. So there have been recent advances in the research laboratory which allow us to measure proteins such as amyloid and tau and alpha-synuclein. Amyloid and tau are the proteins that go awry in Alzheimer's disease, and alpha-synuclein is the protein that goes awry in Parkinson's disease. And these protein measurements can be used as biomarkers of the underlying disease. For example, if we see specific tau changes, this may indicate that a person has definite Alzheimer's disease in life. And we didn't have this available 10 years ago. So this new development is giving us the opportunity to identify if someone in the Alzheimer's disease group actually has Alzheimer's protein changes in their blood. And similarly, we can also look in a frontotemporal dementia group to see if anyone in the frontotemporal dementia group may have Alzheimer's changes in their blood, which may indicate that they may actually have Alzheimer's disease and be misdiagnosed as FTD. And so this is an exciting area that we're moving in, and we're going to have results hopefully very soon. And we're collaborating with an international group in Sweden to be able to get these measurements very quickly so that we can start to understand how seven of these protein biomarkers of interest will help us make associations between underlying brain pathology and disease severity, and we can learn more about these synergies. Finally, I'd like to get to talking about neuropathology for making the ultimate diagnosis. And so autopsies are the way we can examine the brain after death to identify what the cause of their disease was. And so this is the definitive way and the gold standard to diagnosing conditions of the brain. So this helps us get around understanding that more than one pathology may cause their patient's clinical presentation. So we're also going to be approaching people for consent to do this as we move forward. So I'll stop there and pass it back to Dr. Swartz.
Thanks, Mario. So the HANDDS Ontario study stands for Health and Aging and Neurodegenerative Diseases in Ontario. And it's really built on everything we've talked about so far. So we have the foundational study, and we're aiming to move from just doing detailed phenotyping, detailed characterization, to what we call the quadruple aim, where we're trying to get better outcomes for people. We're trying to make things better for the patients. We're trying to make things better for the healthcare system, and we're trying to make things more efficient for clinicians. And so building on the original founding study, The goal towards putting the patient right smack at the center of this, driving all of it, and involving patients and our community advocates in even setting up the questions from the ground up, we've developed HANDDS Ontario. And the goal of HANDDS Ontario is really to support those three levels that we were talking about before. Basic science and discovery on a molecular, genetic, pathological level, so that we can actually unlock some more important clues to this disease, but also using the genetics and the serum molecular information to help guide an individual's care, to help guide treatment interventions or clinical trials, characterizing free living behaviors, characterizing what's happening in the home and in the community, as you see here, pairing that with clinical data, consent to be recontacted, and the administrative health records means that we can follow people through their healthcare journey. And so HANDDS Ontario is really built to be working on all of these across these multiple levels, all with that fundamental goal of partnering with patients. So we call this a research care partnership, where we want to work together so everybody gets something. So participants, volunteers, patients get something that's helpful to them. Physicians, hopefully, who are caring for them can get some information that's useful to them. Basic scientists can be getting some discovery work, and we can understand better how to design and optimize the health system and healthcare funding to support people. So the idea here is wins across multiple levels with the patient experience, the lived experience at the center. We have three objectives for HANDDS Ontario. The first is to try to identify these unique cohorts, groups of people, by their genetic and molecular markers and by their free living behavioral profiles and understand how these go together. And this is really getting to Dr. Masellis' comment that when we put people in clinical buckets, those buckets aren't as pure as people would like to think. And we want to understand how the genetics and how the serum markers all relate to day-to-day function. The second objective is to look at how those three factors, the genetics, the molecular markers of what's happening right now, and the day-to-day behaviors in the community, these multiple multi-dimensional different types of measures, relate to adverse outcomes. So this means the need for long-term care or home care. This means emergency room visits, falls, hospitalizations, even fatalities. We want to understand what puts people at the highest risk so that we can target interventions to make those changes. And the third objective is, as we're collecting this data for these research purposes, can we actually provide that data in a way back to participants that's useful, that's helpful, that can guide their day-to-day management and care, that can give feedback, as Larry said, how I'm moving in a day, you know, should we be moving more? Should we be moving less? Are we at risk of falls if we're moving a certain way? When should we be changing our diet because we're at risk of choking? These kinds of questions that can actually make a real difference to people day-to-day, and that might even be able to collect data that's useful to caregivers or physicians, about what happens in the 99% of the time that you're not in the doctor's office. Can we digest that and package it in such a way that helps patients explain their experience to their physicians or helps their physicians understand some of the challenges and gaps that are happening in the community? So our framework is really building on the initial ONDRI 1 study, using the tools developed and validated through AIM 2 that you're going to hear about a little bit later today, for at-home data collection in the community, free living behaviors, as we call it, partnering with patients and caregivers at the center, putting that data up for collaboration, so anonymized data that is open to researchers in Canada and around the world, and linkage to the robust administrative data we have in Ontario. Our core study elements that we're asking all sub-studies and all core participants to get involved with is wearing some of these remote monitors, biosensors to measure free living behaviors in day-to-day natural environments, giving a blood sample to facilitate the genetic and biomarker studies, provide some minimal clinical data on how you're doing right now, and how what your diagnosis is, medications, and so on. And then agree that we can recontact you to be part of some of these sub-studies, provide a health card number that will be stored, encrypted, and linked to ICES, and allow us to release not the ICES, not the personal health data, but the other anonymized data to collaborate with investigators elsewhere. To start this process, we're building a core. And on that core, we're building some disease-specific projects as well. So the core that, I've just described will be collected across cohorts. The individual studies will actually nuance and modify some of these core elements to answer specific questions within a disease. So we're going to be able to go between diseases. We're also going to be able to target questions within a disease. So you're going to hear a little bit later today about the Parkinson's substudy and the ALS substudy and the long-term care substudy, where we're really, in addition to collecting the basic minimum core amount of remote wearable biosensor data, for example, we're going to be modifying that wear pattern so that we can actually assess longitudinal change over time in people with ALS. To identify risks for falls or aspirations or need for more support in breathing at night and so on. So that's one example, and you're going to hear more details about that. But the data from the sub-studies will be over and above that core data that's collected across all cohorts. Our goal ultimately is to be having targeted cohorts, targeted studies, and eventually to be moving these, if we're hopefully fortunate enough to get funded in future rounds through OBI and the government, would be to build these towards intervention studies to change and improve outcomes. But for now, the goal is to actually perform these studies to collect that data and provide the feedback to individuals, and that would be the intervention. And we're really hoping that this partnership, because I think we see it truly as a partnership between clinicians, researchers, persons living with these diseases, and those that are important to them, so caregivers and family members. And this partnership, I think, is going to advance all of these aims that we've just described. So at this point,